نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. ما بعد, a few moments ago we were looking at some advice to the shabab, the youth, and to the elderly. And we saw that it was important to be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be correct within. We also saw that the advice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is that if you were correct within, this would be seen in your behavior. Also, we saw that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasized certain things outwardly as well. And we dealt with some aspects of that in detail. And it's simply because the issue comes up very often, and also to emphasize the point that it's not only inside our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being aware and being concerned of the life to come, but also there are certain things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires of us, and also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam externally. And we were just simply looking at one aspect of that, we said, because it reoccurs and the discussion always pops up. We mentioned about the youth, them distinguishing themselves, and that outward resemblance causes a type of inner affinity where a person begins to like not only what he imitates outward, but his value system begins to change. For this reason, Allah legislated for the Muslims that they distinguish themselves, to protect ourselves, our value, and the faith that we have. We were looking at this area of wearing the garments and how the men are supposed to wear their garments. And we saw some of the ahadith. We want to conclude this by mentioning just a few others. We have a hadith which is collected by Muslim in his Sahih on the authority of Ibn Umar. He said, I passed by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam وفي إزاري استرخاء, and my waist garment was hanging a bit. فقال يا عبد الله, and he said, O slave of Allah, ارفع إزارك, raise your garment up. فرفعته, he said, so I did so, I raised it up. ثم قال زد, he said, some more, he said, so I did so. فما زلت أتحرها بعد, after that I continued to wear my garment in this manner. Some of the people questioned him, how high above your ankles? He said, إلى أنصاف الساقين, halfway up the calves. This was collected by Muslim. We have another narration which is collected by Abi Dawood. Abi Dawood says, حدثنا حفص بن عمر. حفص بن عمر, when Imam Ahmad speaks about him or spoke about him, he said, ثبتٌ ثبتٌ متقن لا يخذ عليه حرف. Normally when you want to speak about a person who is a scholar of hadith and you want to describe him in a favorable manner, it's sufficient to say ثقتٌ. That means that his recall is good and his accuracy is also impeccable. This individual, Imam Ahmad, he uses three things to describe him. Tabtun, meaning that he is exceptional, exceptional, mutqin, has perfected what he narrates. La yukhadh alayhi harfun, we don't find him making a mistake in one letter. This is Hafs ibn Umar. He narrates this particular narration from Ala ibn Abdul Rahman. هلا بن عبد الرحمن صدوق meaning that his narration is Hassan. And he narrates from his father, عبد الرحمن بن يعقوب, who is a trustworthy individual, who narrates from the Sahabi, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. The hadith in Islam. He says, سألت أبا سعيد الخدري عن الإزار. I questioned Abu Sa'id about the waist garment, the cloth, the garment that we wear. And he said to me, على الخبير سقطت. You have asked a person who is well informed about this. He said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said, Izwaratul Muslim ila nisf al-saq. That the garment of the Muslim should be worn halfway up his calves. ولا حرج ولا جناح فيما بينه وبين الكعبين. There is no sin or anything wrong concerning what is between that and above the ankles. ما كان أسفل من الكعبين فهو في النار. What is beneath the ankles, it is in the fire. Al-Khattabi said, not the garment, but the person is in the fire. This is a warning. Normally, whenever a sin is associated with the fire, it's an indication that it is a major sin. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after mentioning that regulation, he mentions another one. من جر إزاره بطرا لم ينظر الله إليه. And whoever dries his garments or wears it beneath his ankle, out of arrogance, Allah shall not look at him. Two regulations. One, just simply wearing it beneath the ankles. The other one, doing it out of arrogance. Two separate things dealt with in this particular hadith, which was collected by Abi Dawood, the sound chain of narration. We have, يعني actually, Imam al-Bukhari, when he deals with this, he does something that is unique, because some people say, look, in those days they used to wear the waist garment, we wear pants in this day and time. So the regulation was for the waist garment and it wasn't for the pants that we wear. Imam al-Bukhari deals with this in a nice way. He says here that Shu'bah said, I met Muharib ibn Dithar and he was on a horse. And he was going to the place where he normally passed religious rulings and judgments. And so I asked him about this hadith. He said, I heard Abdullah ibn Umar saying that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من جر ثوبه, whoever dries his thawb. In the Arabic language, الثوب هو كل ما يلبس. Thawb is a generic or general expression for everything that is worn. This particular text is chosen by Bukhari for this very reason, according to Hafidh ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, to show that there is no difference between the izar, the waist garment, or any other type of garment that you wear. If it's beneath your ankle, this particular warning applies. It says here, whoever does this, مَخِيلَةً لَمْ يَنْدُرِ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامِ. Whoever does this out of arrogance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall not look at him on يوم القيامة. I said to Muharib, did he mention the izar? He says, no, he did not specify the waist garment nor the qamis. Whether it's the waist garment that you wear or any other type of garment. Now, normally if a person looks at those narrations by themselves, he would say, look, it is not permissible. But look, there are other warnings that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave concerning this attire, this way of dress for the men. Listen to what he said. Abi Dawud. This is collected by Muslim from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, three people, ثلاثة لا يكلمهم الله يوم القيامة. ولا ينظر إليهم ولا يزكيهم ولهم عذاب أليم. Three individuals. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall not speak to on Yawm al-Qiyam. This is a punishment. He shall not look at them. He shall not purify them, and for them is a painful punishment. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited this three times for emphasis. قال أبو ذر خابوا وخسروا منهم يا رسول الله. They have failed, lost. Who are they, O Messenger of Allah? He said, Al-Musbil. يعني المسبل إزاره. The first one he says, the person who wears his garments beneath his ankle. We take that lightly, right? Just consider, man, Allah's messenger chased somebody down the street. He had a deformity, tell him, raise it up, raise it up. So Ibn Umar walk and say, Ya Abdullah, lift it up. Now comes and he emphasizes in this particular hadith, Allah shall not speak to you, not look at you, not purify, and you'll have a painful punishment. And somebody says it's optional to do so. Says here, also included in these, in this category, is the person who sells his good. But he does so while telling a lie. Wallahi, this is the best product you have on the block. Sit down, lie. والمنان, and the person who is منان. المنان is a person who follows up the good that he does with a reminder. Remember what I did for you? These three individuals in this particular text, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has nothing to do with them in the way that was mentioned in this hadith. We have some narrations. I'm just going to mention يعني, one last one. Oh, let's leave that aside. We'll go to the sisters. You know, one time we dealt with these narrations and the sister came out with her dress all the way above her ankles. Right? She wanted to be on the sunnah. So I always find it necessary not to have that repeated again, to point out that this is for the brothers and not for the sisters. So matter of fact, Ibn Umar said, this narration is collected by At-Tirmidhi in his collection of hadith, the chain of sound. He said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever drives his garment out of arrogance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall not look at them on Yawm al-Qiyamah. So Salama said, كَيْفَ تَسْنَعُ النِّسَى بِذُيُولِهِنَّ How are the women to conduct themselves concerning their garments? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يُرْخِينَ شِبْرًا They should lengthen it a hand span. Okay, from the middle of the calves. She said, even تَنْكَشِفْ أَقْدَامُهُمْ If they were to do this, O Messenger of Allah, then their feet would show. When she said that, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يُرَخِينَهُ شِبْرًا أَقْوَنْ ذِرَاعًا Then instead of just a hand span, lengthen it an arm's length. Why? So that the feet would not show. So that the feet would not show. وَلَا يَزِدْنَ عَلَيْهِ And do not add to that. This particular narration shows that the regulation in respect to the lower part of the garment for the sister differs to the brothers. Okay? So the sister, she's supposed to have her whole, and her garments are supposed to be beneath the ankles. Unlike the brothers. Okay? We have some of the companions, yani, who used to actually stop people, get a scissors, and cut it for them. Umar, radiallahu anhu, after he was mortally wounded, okay, because you know when Umar was yani, killed, his stomach was torn open, and they gave him milk and it came out on his lap. They gave him milk to drink and it came right out on his lap. In this state, people came to visit him. And in groups. And one young man came to him. And he started to speak good about Umar. And when he turned away, Umar saw that his garment was beneath his ankles. And Umar said to the people, says, bring him back, bring the young man back to me. And then he said to him, Yabna Akhi, O son of my brother, irfa izara, raise your garment up. فإنه أتقى لربك وأنقى لتوبك. Because it is, in respect to your Lord, a more righteous act. And it is better in keeping your garment clean. Umar, رضي الله عنه, said this. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he made it out. He says, يا عجبا لعمر. How amazing Umar is. إن رأى حق الله عليه فلم يمنعه ما هو فيه أن تكلم به. Says Umar, how amazing he was. Once he saw Allah's right over him to open his mouth, nothing would prevent him no matter what his condition was. It was Umar رضي الله عنه. طيب. I think يعني, that should be sufficient for the brothers and the sisters يعني, to recognize that there are certain things that the Prophet ﷺ emphasized in respect to our dress code, the outer appearance. Along with us being close, trying to develop a close relationship with our Creator, trying to be conscious of the life to come, correcting our intentions, all of those things, primarily. But there are certain things outwardly that are required of us. We cannot disregard them. Some of them emphasized in the way that you have seen. We have other areas that we'd like to touch on, and yani, the discussion in respect to the Shabab and advice to the youth, something that could continue. But one of the things that Ibn Mas'ud mentioned as he was addressing his students, he said, من سره أن يلقى الله غدا مسلما فليحافظ على هؤلاء صلوات حيث ينادى بهن. Whoever would like to meet Allah tomorrow as a Muslim, then let him guard the prayer where the adhan is given. فإن الله قد شرع لنبيكم سنن الهدى. Because Allah has legislated for your messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the pathways of guidance. وَإِنَّهُنَّ مِنْ سُنَنِ الْهُدَىٰ. And these are the pathways to guidance. That is praying in the masjid. وَلَوْ أَنَّكُمْ تَرَكْتُمْ سُنَّةِ نَبِيِّكُمْ لَضَلَلْتُمْ. If you were to give up the sunnah of your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you would go astray. Before he said that, he said, if you were to pray in your home the way this person prays, you would give up the sunnah of your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if you do that, you would go astray. So one of the things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasized is the congregational prayer for the men. The congregational prayer for the men. And guarding the prayer. All of them. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in the hadith of Jabir ibn Abdullah, that which is between a man and shirk and kufr is salah, giving up the prayer. This was collected by Muslim. So much so that some of the Ahlul Ilm are of the opinion that if you give up one salah intentionally, you're no longer a part of this ummah. That is one salah. There is a difference of opinion concerning this, but what it does, it points out the seriousness of the prayer. According to Burayda, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pointed out al-ahd, the covenant between us and them is salah. Who gives it up has disbelief. According to Shaqiq ibn Abdullah, he said that the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam never used to consider any act, if you left it aside, as being kufr or disbelief other than salah.
So much so that we find in some of the books of Aqidah, they deal with this issue as a part of your belief system. So one of the things that we as brothers and sisters have to be mindful of is helping the kids and ourselves to guard the prayer and to put them into practice the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. Also, my advice to myself and to the other brothers and sisters is remember the rights of your parents, of our parents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this quite often in the Quran. Quite often. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَن لَا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And Allah has advised and decreed that you worship none other than Him and be kind to parents. إِحْسَانًا. This particular verse just says إِحْسَانًا. It doesn't point out any specific type of goodness, which implies that any way that you can be good to your parents, it is required. Any way, whether it's verbally or in your actions, any way that you can be, this is something that is a requirement. Parents especially. And they don't have to be Muslims. If you read Surah Luqman, Allah tells you if they struggle against you to commit kufr, do not obey them. وَصَاحِبُهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Nevertheless, accompany them in this dunya in a good and honorable manner. Ibn Umar once saw a man, he was carrying his mother on his shoulder around the Kaaba. His mother. And he was reciting, إِنِّي رِكَابُهَا مُعَذَّرٌ. I am مُذَلَّل. I am رِكَابُهَا. I'm her mount. Her obedient mount. Once her mount, her true mount, gets tired, I will never get tired of her carrying my mother. He turned around to Ibn Umar and says, Hal jazaytuha? Have I repaid her, Ibn Umar? Ibn Umar says, no, not even for one inhalation that she took when giving birth to you. Not for one of them. For this reason, we find that the Sahaba used to direct the kids, look, so one of the brother's kids walking with his father. He says, this your father? He says, yes. He said, don't call him by his name and don't you ever sit before he sits. Respect him. That is past. One of the things then that we have to keep in mind as fathers and as children, our parents. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبْرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْحَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا وَاخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if either of them attains old age in your presence, or both of them, do not say anything disrespectful to them. Not even that sound that you make when you displease under your throat. And do not raise your voice to them. Look, this is Allah in the Quran directing the Muslims to believe. This is in respect to your parents, our parents. Don't ever do that. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. But speak to them in an honorable, dignified manner. وَاخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جِنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ. And lower to them the wings of humility, as if you were just humbling yourself. These are your parents. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us. For mom and dad. And then, O Allah, have mercy on them as they raised me up when I was small. Abi Bakr al-Nufay' ibn al-Harith, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting amongst them one day. This is collected by both Bukhari and Muslim. And he said, shall I not inform you of the gravest of all sins? He said it three times. قلنا بلى يا رسول الله. He said, yes, O Messenger of Allah, teach us. inform us about this. He said, Al-Ishraqu Billah, that you should associate anything with Allah, wa Uquq Al-Walidain, and disobedience to parents. And disobedience to parents. One of the things also, in terms of advice, for myself, all the brothers and sisters, is guarding the tongue. Guarding the tongue. We know the Prophet ﷺ taught us that a person, sometimes he speaks a word. He doesn't consider this word which comes out of his mouth. He doesn't give it any thought. But it causes him to go to the fire. It causes him to go to the fire. One of the things that the Prophet ﷺ warned against is backbiting. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said, when I was taken up, and this was a time, yani, when he was taken up, it was after he was the boycott, when they were in that plane, Shebi Abi Talib, that area where Bani Hashim and others were for 3 years, and it was a very difficult time. It was at this time that Abi Talib died and Khadija radiallahu anha. And so it was a very difficult period, and so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by taking him up the night journey and the ascension. There were certain things that were shown to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam during this time. Amongst the things, he said, لَمَّ عُرِجَ بِي مَرَرْتُ بِقَوْمٍ لَهُمْ أَثْفَارٌ مِنْ نُحَاسٍ. I passed by a group of people, they had brass fingernails. يَخْمِشُونَ وَجُوهَهُمْ وَصُدُورَهُمْ. And they were taking the flesh off of their faces and their chests with these nails. فَقُلْتُ مَنْ هَؤُلَىٰ يَا جِبْرِيلُ. I said, oh Jibreel, who are these people? He said, these are the people who backbite. These are the people, يَأْكُلُونَ لُقُومَ النَّاسِ. They eat the flesh of other people and touch their honor. It was connected by Abi Dawood, and it's a sound narration. So one of the things that we all have to be concerned about is the tongue. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to occupy it in a way that is pleasing to Him. Or to have it preoccupied in a way that is pleasing to Him. In the area of the relation between the husband and the wife, we want to go on to some other family issues here. We've been taught a number of things in the Quran and in the Sunnah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when speaking to the men, He said, عَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, and live with them honorably, brothers to their wives. Be kind to them. Allah mentions in the Quran, وَلَهُنَّ مِثْلُ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, and they have rights due to them like those that are upon them in a just manner. For this reason, Ibn Abbas, when he read this verse, he said, for this reason I adorn myself for my wife the same way I like her to adorn herself for me. This was Ibn Abbas. Muawiyah ibn Haydah, he said, I asked or questioned Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ما حق زوجتي أحدنا علي? What is the right that our wives have over us? قال, أن تطعمها إذا طعمت. To feed her when you feed yourself. And تكسوها إذا اقتسيت. To clothe her when you clothe yourself. ولا تضرب الوجه. Do not hit her in her face. ولا تقبح. تقبح يعني قبحك الله. Do not say that to her. May Allah disgrace you and all of that. In other words, don't say anything displeasing to her. ولا تهجر إلا في البيت. And do not leave off relations with her except in the home. If you're angry with her, this should be done in the home. So there's a discussion of the Ahlul Ilm concerning this. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was upset with his wives, he left home and he spent the time outside of the home. Many of the Ahlul Ilm said this act of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shows permissibility to do that. Alright, so it's almost like an explanation to this particular hadith as well as to the verse that we find in the Quran. This particular narration was collected by Abi Dawood with a good chain of narration. Now here, this particular hadith points out that the brothers are responsible for providing for their wives, not the government. The men, the Muslim men, are responsible for providing for their women folks, not the government. Sometimes we have the brothers, the women are providing for them, and they do nothing. You know, that's unheard of in our deen. You know, I mean, if she wants to help whilst you struggle along with her and you're trying to do your best, and she out of the goodness of her heart, she shares something with you, alhamdulillah. But you sitting down at home, minding the children, and she goes out to work from 9 to 5, comes and she pays all the rent, that is not Islamic. That's pimping. That has no place in this deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us, and He taught us well. Well, you see, inshallah, the responsibility that the brothers have, some more of it. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to do certain things that would make his wife feel comfortable. Right? Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, I would be drinking something whilst on my monthly cycle. And I would give it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he would turn the glass around to find out where I had placed my lips, and he would drink from that spot. Right? Yeah. She said, and I would have a bone with a little bit of meat on it, and then I would give it to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he would find the place where I had placed my lips, and he would put his lips on the same place sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes we find that the brothers might marry a sister who was not the same age. This particular advice Aisha radiallahu anha gives, she says, the people of Habasha used to be playing, you know, doing their little war thing with their lances and things like that. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would have me covered up, and I would be looking at them. And he would allow me to stay there until I got tired and turned away. She says, so consider the need of a young girl for pastime and play. If you marry your sister who is a little bit younger, don't expect her to be a certain way, maybe the way you are, or, you know, give her some time to enjoy herself. Play with her. Give us some time for recreation. This is what Aisha radiallahu anha advises. Consider a need for this pastime. This is collected by Bukhari and Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to encourage you enjoying yourself, playing and laughing with your wife. Jabir ibn Abdullah, he got married, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Bikran or Sayyiba? Said, you got married to a virgin girl? A one who was previously married. Jabir says, Tayyiban. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, why not a virgin girl, one that you will cause to laugh and one that will cause you to laugh? One that you could play with and one that will play with you. This particular statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shows that this is something that is not only acceptable, it's encouraged. You're spending this time and enjoying one another's company in this manner. It only helps the relationship. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to Aisha radiallahu anha, He used to do these kinds of things. He would be with his Jayshan in the army. Right? I want you to figure this now. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the army tells them, go ahead, hold Aisha back. Says, let's race. Huh? Let's race. So she goes ahead and she, you know, she's a bit younger. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she takes off and she beats him. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam waits for some time until she gets a little bit heavier and says, now let's race. Goes and takes off, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam beats her and smiles and says, this is for that time. Hadhihi bitilk alayhi salatu wa salam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us yani how to deal, how to relate with our wives, to be kind to them, to be loving, affectionate. You don't have to be straight-jacketed. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not. Smile with them, spending the time with them. Checking them out, see how they were, they're comfortable. Came on Aisha radiallahu anha, she was crying. What's the matter? And then he soothed her. Gave her some comforting words, alayhi salatu wa salam. You know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us that you have in Him the best of examples, these are some of the areas that we need to reflect on also. Aisha radiallahu anha left us with a number of things concerning the Prophet's character sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of the things that he alayhi salatu wa salam used to warn the people against was tajassus. And trying to spy on your wife. Trying to meet in a state when she's not prepared. You come from a journey, she's expecting you next week, you come today. The house looks like a, looks terrible. So what? She's not prepared, she's running around, taking care of the kids, she probably has on that dress that she never worn for 40 years. Okay, the house is terrible. Right? She didn't take a bath yesterday or the day before because she's running around with the kids. She didn't expect you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when they had come from one of the battles and the brothers went to go out, go at home at night, the sisters weren't prepared for it. He says, no, don't do this. Don't do this. Not until حَتَّى تَمْتَشِفَ الشَّعِفَ وَتَسْتَحِدَّ الْمَغِيبَ وَتَسْتَحِدَّ الْمَغِيبَ. Said no until the sister has the time to fix her hair, to shave herself, to get herself prepared for your coming. Don't do it. Give her a chance. Be mindful of these little affairs. Don't try to find the shortcomings. No, I won't catch her now. Don't do that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned against that and encouraged. Encourage the believers by saying, the most complete believer in terms of iman, ahsanum khuluqan, those who have the best character. And the best of you, khiyarukum khiyarukum li nisa'ihim, and the best of you are those who are good to their women folks. This was collected by Tirmidhi with a good chain of narration. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, when he says, "Istausu bin nisa'i khayra," see, good counsel concerning women. It's almost like a social thing. Sometimes you have to check with the brothers who have some experience, you know, and say, you know, brother, give me some words of advice. And you'll be surprised what some of them old heads come up with. They help you out. So don't feel ashamed to go and ask some advice. You know, they have a trick or two up their sleeves, man. It's beneficial, believe me. Hey, one of the things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned against. See, being the husband means that you have a position of authority in the home. But it doesn't mean that you have the right to be a tyrant in your home and over your family. That position of leadership doesn't mean that you have the right to oppress anybody. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once supplicated in a general way, and it includes the guardianship that the husband has over his home. He says, Allahumma, O Allah, من ولي من أمر أمتي شيئا فشق عليهم فشقق عليهم. Whoever is given charge over any affair in my ummah, no matter what it is, and he makes things difficult for them, then be difficult to him. ومن ولي من أمر أمتي شيئا فرفق بهم فرفق بهم فرفق به. And whoever takes a position of authority in my ummah, no matter what it is, and he's gentle with the people under his care, whether it's his wife or somebody else, whoever is gentle to them, oh Allah, be gentle with him. This was collected by Muslim. For this reason, we find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraging rifq, gentleness. Aisha radiallahu anha said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say, gentleness, إن الرفق لا يكون في شيء إلا زانه. Gentleness, whenever it accompanies something, it adorns it. ولا ينزع من شيء إلا شانه. And whenever it's taken away from anything that we do, and you can think of a whole lot of things that we do, when gentleness is taken away, it causes a blemish in the act that we perform. This was collected by Muslim. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the brothers that, look, we're responsible. We have to stand up and be men, but not men that came off the streets with no tarbiyah islamiyah, without any Islamic training. Men after the model of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And to look into his character and to take from it and benefit ourselves and our families. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions, الرجال قوامون على النساء بما فضل الله بعضهم على بعض وبما أنفقوا من أموالهم فالصالحات قانتات حافظات للغيب بما حفظ الله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that men are protectors and maintainers of the women folk. This is because of the virtue, the benefit that Allah has given to one above the other, and because of them spending their wealth to take care of them. Here again, the brothers are responsible for taking care of the sisters. فَالصَّالِحَاتْ قَانِتَاتْ. So righteous women are obedient to Allah and to their husbands. Look, I don't care what you say. If you ain't obedient to your Lord and you are disobedient to your husband, I don't care what you claim, you're not righteous. Sister, no matter what you say about you being, if you're not, Allah says it, for salihat, the righteous ones are obedient. حَافِظَاتٌ لِلْغَيْبِ. And they protect themselves in the absence of their husband and his wealth and his property. According to what Allah has required of them to protect. So sisters, Allah is teaching us, you know, for you to claim righteousness, you have to be doing something. You have to be obedient to your zawj, as long as he doesn't command you to do something wrong and haram or forbidden. That's the position that Allah gives us in the bayt, the men. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in speaking about this, he said, إِذَا صَلَّتِ الْمَرْأَةُ خَمْسَهَا. If a lady performs the five prayers, وَصَامَ شَهْرَهَا, and she fasts the month, وَحَفِظَتْ فَرْجَهَا, and she guards her honor, وَأَطَاعَتْ زَوْجَهَا, and she obeys her husband, قيل لها أدخل الجنة من أي أبوابها شئت. It shall be said to her, enter any of the doors of paradise you like. Any of them, choose. Ibn Hibban narrates this particular narration. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when speaking about the system, Abi Hurairah said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was questioned, which lady is best? He says, التي تطيعه إذا أمر, the one who obeys him when he commands. وتسره إذا نذر, and she pleases him when he looks at her. You know, some sisters, they wait till they go in with the sisters to get dressed up. And when the brother's home, they find the worst apron they could find to put on. I mean, ain't got a cent on. The worst, I mean, just the brothers in LA say, toe up. Right? I mean, no concern, but as soon as she's getting ready to go with the sisters, takes that bath. Make sure the hair is looking good. Huh? Gotta put that little, the dress gotta be perfectly ironed. No! The one who deserves this more than anybody else is your husband. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when questioned which of the women is best, that one, when you look at it, you're pleased. You're pleased. I mean, you might not, she might not, she has to take care of her wifely chores and things at the home, but sometimes, at least, when you open the door, man, sister, let him see something that is pleasing to his eyes. And then, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says, تَحْفَظُهُ فِي نَفْسِهَا وَمَالِهِ, and she protects him, guards his wealth, and she guards herself in his absence. You don't have to worry about her. Man, he turns his back, mashallah, man, that's taken care of. Don't worry about that sister, she's on her deen. You don't be looking at no other brother. I don't even have to think about that. According to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, this is the good sister. And if we don't have it, sisters, we need to check ourselves. Now, just like the brothers, we got to check ourselves. Hussein ibn Mihsan, he said that his aunt once came, told him that she came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam questioned her, أَذَاتُ زَوْجٍ أَنْتِ, do you have a husband? She said, "Naam, yes." Says, "فَأَيْنَ أَنْتِ مِنْهُ, what is your condition and your affair with him?" She said, "مَا آلُوهُ إِلَّا مَا عَجَزْتُ عَنْهُ." Says, "I try not to fall short in anything concerning him except what I'm unable to do." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told her, "فَانْدُرِي, أَيْنَ أَنْتِ مِنْهُ." See what your state is with him. See what your state is with him. فَإِنَّهُ جَنَّتُكِ وَنَارُكِ, because he is your paradise and your fire. If you obey him, you please him, then you got your way, you got a road to Jannah. But you act mean to him, you disrespect him, then he could be a source of the flames for you. This was collected by an Nasa'i in his book, Ishratun Nisa, Living with the Women Folks. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then, he points out certain rights for the brothers, how they're supposed to conduct themselves, being kind, gentle, standing up, and how the sisters are supposed to conduct themselves as well. And once we have the Quran and the Sunnah at play in the home, and we have a home that is Islamic. We have sisters, man, they think, look, he can't tell me when I gotta come home, or when I can leave. gotta ask him to go out. We have sisters with that mentality. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith, narrated by Ibn Umar, he says, if one of you, his wife, seeks permission, focus on this, seeks permission to go to the masjid, then don't prevent it. Now, she is supposed to seek permission to go to a place of worship. What do you think about the marketplace? Or kicking it with the sisters around the corner? For this reason, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah says, لا يحل للزوجة أن تخرج من بيت زوجها إلا بإذنه. It is not permissible for a sister to leave her husband's house without his permission. And you come home, she all the way down in, I mean, 2 hours away, kicking it. And she comes home, you better don't ask her. That's not the Islamic way. That's not the Muslim sister who is on her deen. That may be a sister, a lady on the street, who has no upbringing, who has never heard the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah. That may be her. But not a sister who believes in Allah on the last day. Not a sister who believes in Allah on the last day. We got some, look. I'm just looking to see what my audience is like. See, I want to interpret this one. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, if I were to command anyone to make sajda, to go down on their face in humility and submission to anyone other than Allah, I would have commanded the wife to do this to her husband. I swear by him in whose hand is the soul of Muhammad, a lady will never discharge the right that she owes to Allah until she discharges the right that is due to her husband. Even if she's on the camel sitting down and he says, come, he ain't calling for food. He's calling for some intimacy. Even if you're in that state, she should not prevent herself. Be prepared. You know, Aisha radiallahu anha, she was unable to make up her fast from one Ramadan to the next, except in Sha'ban, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to be fasting. Why? She was always prepared for him. Don't know when he's going to come home and give her that look. And she was prepared. She understood the deen. But some brothers gotta suffer because the sister don't understand. There shouldn't be no hustling and tussling and talking and all that. No. All he has to do is give you that little sly wink look and you know what time it is. That's how it's supposed to be. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us this, why it's a protection for the community. It's a protection for the community, for the family. And when we put these things into practice, brothers and sisters, look, you know, you know, this deen of ours is not from mankind. What has been revealed is from Al-Hakim Al-Hamid, the one who is all wise and deserves praise because of the many qualities that he has. And Allah knows better for us than we know for ourselves. So when he legislates something, we should submit. And then when we submit, then we begin to see the barakah. Right? You know, there is something that I want to read to the brothers and sisters. And at best you can say it's some wisdom. This person is giving advice, a mother to a daughter. She says, Ya Bunayya, if advice were to be left aside because of the virtue of an individual, then I know that you really don't need any advice. She was raised up, man. I told her her training was good. Her mother says, but it is a reminder for a person who might be negligent. And it is assistance for a person who has intellect and intelligence. If any lady could be free of having a husband because of the wealth of her parents and because of the need of her parents for her, you would be the most wealthy of all people. She said, but the women were created for the men. وَهُنَّ خُلِقَ الرِّجَالِ And then the women were created for the men and the men were created to have women as their companions. She said, my daughter, you have left the atmosphere that you were raised in. You have left the nest that you grew up in. And you go into a den that you don't understand. With a person, a companion that you truly don't know yet. And he has the authority now to be a watcher over you. فَكُونِي لَهُ أَمَّةً يَكُنْ لَقِي عَبْدًا Says, be a maid servant to him and he shall be a slave for you. Be a maid servant to him and he will be your slave. Just treat him good. And you will have both pockets, his shoes and his everything. This is mom teaching. Says, protect concerning him 10 characteristics. This is your husband. Guard these things. Be humble to him in a state of contentness. Don't be complaining. Well, some sisters, man, you can't satisfy them. Maybe, you know, you give them a Rolls Royce tomorrow. It's too old the next day. Humble to him in a state of contentment. Be attentive and obedient. When your husband speaks to you, be attentive. Listen to him. Those were the first two advices she gave. She says, guard these things. The third and the fourth, have concern for what his eyes fall upon. This is in respect to her character and how she attires herself. Be mindful about this. And also his sense of smell. Says here, and do not allow his eyes to fall upon that which is distasteful from you. Be pleasing to his eyes. Can he dress up for him every now and then? Let him see something that's pleasing. Says here, and let him find in you only the most pleasant of aromas. When he comes next to you, that shampoo in your hair, the type of oils that you have on in your house, you're not supposed to wear when you go out. But in your home, let him smell, you know, let him smell it. Says, goes on to 5 and 6. Says, be watchful of his sleep time and the time he eats. Learn your husband's habits. Help him out. Says here, because constant hunger agitates. No. Constant hunger agitates. And a lack of sleep angers. Help him out in these areas. He comes home, make sure that, you know, he's taken care of. 7 and 8. Says God is what? And oversee his children well. Says here, the controlling of fear with wealth is good management. Your husband gives you something, manage it well. And with the children, good organization. If you organize, you can teach them. She's teaching a daughter, man, you're going to get married. Consider these advices here. Says here, 9 and 10. Says, do not disobey anything that he commands you, and do not spread outside of the home what he holds secret. Don't do that. Yarhamukallah. Says, if you disregard his command, you shall cause his chest to be restricted. That openness that you once used to experience will go away. And if you spread the secret that he shares with you, says here, you will never be secured against his cunning. He won't trust you no more. This particular sister, she gives this advice. And there was a concluding statement. Now I'll be able to find this week. She says here, and be aware of showing laughter and joy when he's sad, or being sad when he wants to be happy. Don't display this in front of him. This mother, she starts out, I consider this advice of hers to probably be the most important. Be to him a maid servant, and he shall be your slave. You want to win his heart? Just be kind to the brother. Don't always be up in his face, arguing with him toe to toe. You disagree with something, you nose to nose with him like you are. That's not the attitude of the Muslimah. The home, look, if the home were to be a ship, then the compass is the Quran and the Sunnah. If the compass is not working, if it's not activated, you are going to be shipwrecked. In the home, if the Quran and Sunnah is not activated, it's disaster. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given a responsibility to the brothers and to the sisters. And have given them responsibilities suitable to themselves for the benefit of the family and the home and the society. That's where it starts. So what we need to do, brothers and sisters, we need to take some of these teachings and start implementing them, putting them into practice so that our homes could be different, the family, the environment, and so that children would have a chance to see at least one or two families surviving. We have too many casualties. Oh, they were married yesterday. He was married, man, this is his 7th zawja. No, that's sad. You know, one time ago, it used to be difficult. People, you know, new converts memorizing the Quran, used to be difficult, man. That's difficult. But after they see so many success stories, man, if he could do it, she could do it, man, it's easy. All people have is fail families, broken families. They don't ever see any example success stories. What legacy we're leaving for the kids? The first thing something goes wrong, I want a khula. They don't say it like that. They say it some other way, kulo, something like that. You know. They learn that word before they learn how to say the shahada real good. But inshallah, tomorrow we'll deal with marriage and divorce. Inshallah. But for right now, I think my time is up. I went over time. but inshallah, I think we have a